is a veritable orgy of over-the-top important news and information to cover today on the 17th day of August 2015, Monday broadcast. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We're simulcasting via the radio and TV at Infowars.com/show and on over 170 AM/FM affiliates across the United States, Global Shortwave, WWCR, Satellite, and many other platforms. Again, thank you for joining us. There is a ton of huge news today, obviously. I'm going to be plowing back in to Donald Trump coming out against Hillary and saying she should step down and that basically she's a criminal. That is not the actions of somebody who is working for the Clintons. And when he piled on, you can definitely say that that was the straw that broke the camel's back. And if you look at DrudgeReport.com today, there's the Washington Post. Bob Woodward of Naval Intelligence, he was sent to bring down Nixon. Not saying Nixon was good, but it was a governmental coup over the executive branch. Now we have that same corporate coup over all the branches. That's what globalism is a corporate takeover. But Woodward now firing at the Clintons. Something he's never done. And when that starts happening, we are now approaching the point where I think it's about a 90% chance the Clintons are going to be destroyed. They know where the dirt is. They know where the bodies are buried. They know where the skeletons are. They know what closets to look in. But the whole system's lining up against them right now. And they are in what I believe a terminal spiral. They may just scurry off like Pope Benedict to, you know, Gandalf Castle, figuratively, into absentia, you know, into some type of purgatory. But they are critically, politically wounded. Clinton looks like he's dying. That may have something to do with it. Bill Clinton looks like he is a couple steps from the grave. Bob Woodward, he says, reminds me of the Nixon tapes, talking about Hillary and the erased emails. Again, last week when the FBI raided her offices, they spun it that, oh, they just came and picked up hard drives. No, they raided Hillary's offices and her staff and then the entire chain to show the obstruction of justice. Holder has left. He's put somebody in who's continuing the persecution via the IRS of Liberty Groups. So I don't know what to say at this point, but there is a major battle going on in government. I've got a pretty good idea exactly what's going on. We'll break it down today. But I want to go out to break with this clip we played yesterday. It's been airing since Friday. With Hillary Clinton and her beyond arrogance, hubris, chutzpah, bravado, just making jokes about disappearing emails, talking about Snapchat, trying to put a confidence face on it. Here's that clip.
So I am delighted to be here with you and with my fellow candidates.
It's all a confidence game.
I know that people across the country are following us on social media as well. By the way, you may have seen that I recently launched a Snapchat account.
Look at this arrogance.
I love it. Those messages disappear all by themselves.
Oh, look at that evil criminal Joker smile. I mean, she is a master villain. A criminal, a gangster, a monster, just a total monster. A momster. That's a new word for her. But that's only because I hate women. I mean, it's not that she's a criminal. It's totally legitimate. Just let her do whatever she wants, break any laws, because she's kind of our Lord and Savior. Thank you for joining me, my friends. Thank you for joining us here at InfoWars, coming to you from deep in the heart of Texas. We'll be here for the next 3 hours, broadcasting worldwide, as we are Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. Don't forget InfoWars Nightly News, 7 o'clock Central as well. Details at InfoWarsNews.com or PrisonPlanet.tv. Let me mention just some of the big news we're going to be covering today, some of the guests that are coming up. And then I will plow into the latest on Donald Trump and how serious the situation is getting for the establishment. My gut tells me not to completely trust Donald Trump, but also not to completely judge him and say that he's an operative completely. And now I've moved from 50-50 on Trump to 60-40 towards him. Because what he's doing is hurting the establishment. And I could see all the angles of how he ends up helping Hillary. In fact, we have a piece Paul Watson did last week for InfoWars Nightly News. I never aired on the radio. I want to play that with his perspective on how Trump's bad at the bottom of the hour. But then I'm going to go over why Trump may be good. And I want to be clear, I'm not endorsing Donald Trump. I'm simply just not going to be the ultimate cynic, ultimate critic. I'm going to wait until he sells people out, and then not just myself, but tens of millions of others are going to make sure he's politically and financially punished. And Trump's not stupid. That's why I've looked at every angle, and something big's going on here, and it's beyond Trump. That's coming up. Now, let's get to the most important news that's bigger than this country, bigger than Donald Trump, bigger than this election. This is the London Telegraph. This is not InfoWars, but they're saying exactly what we're saying after we've been saying it. Doomsday clock for global market crash strikes 1 minute to midnight as central banks lose control. That's coming up. That's on InfoWars.com right now. Ron Paul, Fed may need hike because everything is vulnerable. China's move to devalue its currency roiled the markets last week and stoked new fears about the health of the world's third largest economy. China has the second largest economy. Did you know that the U.S. no longer has any strategic grain reserves at all? Yeah, and the food banks are running out of food. And I mean, at a record level. We got 100 million people on food assistance. 100 million. It's like 101 mil. Right at 46 to 49, depending on the month, on direct digital food stamp. Greek government on its last legs while Angela Merkel faces growing rebellion in Berlin. Deep wounds within the ruling party are growing. Disquiet in Berlin threatened to derail political support before the new $86 billion Greek rescue is secured. You mean the next banker's snack that they admit won't even get them out of debt. So that's some of the news on that front. Hundreds of casualties in air raids on Syrian market, and the media is demonizing the Syrian government, saying, how dare they? It looks like a bunch of civilians got killed because Al-Qaeda, ISIS, as they always do, base their head base in the city they've taken over, this is admitted, in the middle of the market, because there's buildings within the market. Syria has now turned the tide against the rebels 2 years ago. Now they've had the tide turned against them. The rebels hold more than 60% of the country. They're taking major towns and cities every week. Russia is basically starting to withdraw support from Syria. It looks like it's going to fall to Al-Qaeda. And they are going to murder every Christian and Jew they get their hands on. And then you'll hear our media go, gee, Syria's so failed. They're killing everyone. It's so sad. Just like Libya. So the UN condemns Syrian market attack as witnesses tell of corpses everywhere. The United States was attacked by Japan and 4 years later dropped two atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. You can question that in hindsight, but the United States was fighting for its life at one point. And so morally, historically, we probably went overboard, but you can still say it doesn't matter. We didn't start the fight. It's like if some guy starts a fight with you and you fight back and he falls down and hits his head on the pavement, goes into a coma and dies from a subdermal hematoma, they might even take you to jail for it. But the grand jury says no indictment because the witnesses come in and say, Mr. Smith attacked Mr. Johnson. Or Mr. Jones attacked Mr. Sanchez. Syria's fighting for its life. Al-Qaeda bases itself in the middle of civilian areas. Syria's not been targeting civilians, but now they're fighting for their life. They've got to take out Al-Qaeda. And these towns and cities that have markets and let Al-Qaeda sit there and be based in their town, I mean, what do you expect to happen? Because here's the deal. Syria is fighting for its life, and this could go on for a couple more years. It's over 350,000 people now dead, almost all of them killed by the Al-Qaeda forces. And our media is just really getting off on demonizing Syria right now. And I'm sad for the civilians that are dead, but Syria didn't start this. Where's the media when Al-Qaeda and ISIS, the first 3-4 years, was doing this? They wouldn't even cover it. They called them the wonderful rebels, and John McCain went and met with them. The main new group that the U.S. just spent a year training, 10,000-plus troops, just swore allegiance to ISIS and al-Nusra last Friday. Kurt Nemo wrote about it. It was in Reuters as well, but it's at InfoWars.com. Where is the coverage of that? They kill hundreds of thousands of people. They rape and murder women. They rape women to death. How do you do that? They'll have like 300 guys rape and beat a woman. It was in the news just this weekend how they rape women to death until they die. In fact, just type ISIS rapes woman to death. And they don't even do it for the sex. They do it to torture. What a bunch of weird freaks. Rape's bad enough, but my goodness. Hundreds of men keeping a woman up for 3-4 days, beating her and raping her to death. Kyla Mueller was raped by ISIS leader before her death, say officials, London Guardian. She's not even the one I'm talking about. There was another one I saw where they raped her to death. And nothing's going to be done about that. I mean, Jeb Bush is saying bomb Assad to stop ISIS. What? Trump's come out against him saying he's a puppet. We're going to get to all that. Apollo 14 astronaut claims peace-loving aliens prevented nuclear war on Earth. Edgar Mitchell says flying saucers followed their ships on the moon. That was kept classified for decades, but Australian radio technicians were able to pick it up. That's how we have the recordings. There's a lot of weird stuff going on, folks. I don't even get into it, but we're going to be covering that. Inflatable space elevator invented by scientists. That's really important. New report, massive immigration surge from Mexico taking place. Two white sorority videos slammed for being racially homogeneous. Just, you know, it's bad if you happen to be a predominantly white fraternity. Well, why are there totally black fraternities, totally Hispanic fraternities? I mean, I'm going to do a piece where I'm going to go out to some of these black bars in East Austin. I'm going to walk in with a camera. I'm not kidding. If I have the time, I'll do it. Or my reporters ought to. I'm not scared to do it. Folks will laugh and think it's funny. But I'm going to go into a totally black bar. There's a whole bunch of them in East Austin. I'm going to walk in and go, why is this so black? They're going to say, excuse me? I'm going to say, oh, man, it's a joke. I'm doing a piece. Like, oh, Alex Jones. Watch. I think I'm going to do it. And I'll be, oh, I'm just in here filming for a show. What do you think about this? And I'll sit back and have a beer. The point is that it's not racist that if you grow up around a bunch of people and that's what you're used to, that's what you do. They got Japanese fraternities. There's not Chinese in them. They're Japanese. They got Chinese fraternities. There's not Mexicans in them. Because it's the culture. It's what it is. It's that if you hate other people and then don't want to work with them, that's racist. But we're going to get to that. It's all coming up. Now, briefly before we go to break here, we got Prostagard, a large shipment back in. It is the strongest, most concentrated, with 10 ingredients. Saw palmetto, the government admits, is an alternative treatment for prostate problems. They admit in double-blind studies it's better than a lot of the drugs out there. We have concentrated organic saw palmetto, but then 9 other ingredients known to supercharge it. It doesn't just help the prostate. It's available. It is, again, half the price of the leading competitor. Just look it up for yourself. It's $19.95. It's super strong. I take it every day, and it just really makes life a lot better. Not that I had any problem with my prostate, but at 40-something, you know, I'm not going to get into it. Everybody knows what the prostate does. You want to supercharge it and a lot of other stuff. From my experience, ProstaGuard is for you. The reviews are there on the page, third-party reviews. Here's JB for Liberty. This is a fantastic supplement for the prostate. I began taking this every morning. That took 2 to 3 weeks, but after that, I really began feeling the effects. My consistent feeling of urination throughout the night went away. That's from swelling in it, and I feel great. I mixed the supplement into several other items, such as Supernova Vitality and Nascent Iodine, and are wonderful and truly helped my body regulate and feeling healthier. JB for Liberty, Los Angeles, California, on ProstaGuard at InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. And the last bottles of Brain Force are about to sell out. The incredible brain pill. Experience it and support the broadcast. InfoWarsLife.com. So coming up, two white sorority videos slammed for being racially homogeneous. So if you ever see a rap video with nothing but black people in it, or you ever see a Hispanic group of people out at a park, go up and say, why are you so racist? Why are there 300 Hispanic people at this park barbecuing? Where are the black people? Where are the white people? Racist, racist, racist. No, what's racist is implying that being white or being black or being Hispanic is inherently bad. And the feminist group is complaining about this, doesn't like it, because it's a bunch of really good-looking women. And as we know, modern feminists, for whatever reason, they have international studies out, are 3 times fatter and on beauty scales much lower. And it turns out they want to dominate women and tell women what to do. And I'm not against lesbians or anything, but let's face it, predominantly a lot of hardcore feminists are lesbians who just want to pimp women. And hey, more power to them. I mean, I'm being sarcastic, but I am impressed by some of the dog ugly women I see wearing, you know, blue jeans, and they got a chain on their wallet, short haircut, and they're dressing down their hot blonde girlfriend, you know, who's got her nails done just right, looks like Marilyn Monroe. And I hear about the police reports where you got the lesbians beating up their girlfriends and their wives. I mean, you'll see like some giant, you know, fat woman with tattoos everywhere. She's got a girlfriend, looks like she's going to be the centerfold next week's Playboy. And that's just how they roll. And the women bow down and they follow their daddy. I mean, I'm sorry. That's what this is really all about. And of course, Gloria Steinem also tells you that you shouldn't have any kids, but she's got a whole bunch of them. So a lot of them are just traditional women as well. They just want to tell women what to do. That's a big market. Not me. I just want to empower women. I got 2 daughters. And, you know, that's why they're starting to take martial arts and learn how to shoot. And I'm teaching them, you know, that if somebody attacks them, how to kick them in the groin. And they're learning how to defend themselves. And that's something feminists wouldn't do, because they want women domesticated and families broken up so that woman can be alone at 45 and can't have kids and doesn't have a man around so they can be comfortably euthanized at 65. And that's the actuarial plan. So we're going to get into that coming up. But you got to admit, it's a great con game. It's a great confidence game by Hillary and all the rest of her types, that they are the men now. And they dress like men. They talk like men. They've taught men to be subservient, act like little boys. And they get all the girls. Hillary gets all the girls for herself. And she should be proud of that. I mean, you think these Mac Daddy rapper guys got a bunch of girls in their videos? Hillary's got it for real. Rolling in the crib. She got the drugs, everything. Party time, baby. And Bill likes the girls, too. We got Larry Nichols coming on to tell us all about it, former Clinton insider. Even the New York Times admits that's who Clinton worries about at night. We're talking about the fall of Hillary Clinton and Bill coming up. It looks like it might be happening. But speaking of the devil, let's go to this clip of Hillary talking about how Vladimir Putin is like the guy from House of Cards. No, Vladimir Putin's former KGB and a tough guy and reportedly was an assassin. But he rules by straight shooting and has an 87% approval rating. He's a strong man publicly. House of Cards guy is a manipulating crook who acts like a sweet, non-threatening person. That's you, Hillary. So here she is saying Putin is House of Cards. You talk about distorting reality. Here it is.
But finally, just let me quickly say Putin and Russia troubling. How many of you have seen the last season of House of Cards? I mean, he's a lot taller than Putin, but the actor playing him, based on my experience negotiating with and being with Putin, is right on the money. It's really quite remarkable.
This woman is working with Soros with $5 billion to overthrow Ukraine, did that. They're attacking Russia. They're trying to bankrupt Russia, which will then hurt Europe and hurt the U.S. She's a total crook, a lying fraud. And then she says Putin operates like that. Putin operates the opposite, a classic Russian strongman, straight shooting. But he will not sit there and sell his country out. And so Hillary hates his guts. She's the gangster, making jokes about disappearing her emails, making jokes about she came to Libya and Gaddafi died. In fact, we'll cue that up. That's House of Cards crap. I mean, basically, House of Cards is based on a Democrat, based on the Clintons. So it's just a sick joke. And everybody knows in Hollywood that's based on the Clintons, a Southern politician. Monday through Friday from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central. Thank you for joining us. And I'll say this, words are very unnecessary when we take calls later. Please don't thank me. I want to thank all of you, the listeners and viewers, and the supporters of every race, color, creed around this world that make this transmission possible. We're all on the same team, Team Humanity. Thank you so much for your support. I want to get into the huge economic news that continues to get more dire. And a lot of people say, oh, be confident, that'll fix things. That's what's maneuvered us into this position. There are ways to turn our economies back on, cut taxes and cut government spending. And there will be some pain, but if we don't, it'll be much worse. Historical, mathematics, common sense, it all says it. There's no debate. And we're coming to the end of the line. Who does that song? Tom Petty? At the end of the line. At the end of the line. We got to play that coming up at the start of the next segment. Because we're coming to the end of the line, and I want there to be something decent at the end of the line. The line we're going down here on this train goes to a very bad place. There's a few spurs. There's a few other switch points where we could go somewhere else coming up. But already earlier turns that were a lot better, we've gone past those. And in the future, the train only goes forward. So we've got to exit here quick. We got to pick the right exit. And so that's why I'm getting in to the problems, is not to scare people, but to admit the problems we have so we can do something about them. So many people criticize this broadcast, saying, man, it's just gloom and doom. It's so negative. He just wants to scare you. And I guess it really is a fundamental difference in philosophies. Because if my house is being robbed and my neighbor's across the street while I'm asleep and sees the person breaking in my back door, and my neighbor calls up and says, hey, Alex, looks like somebody's breaking in your back door. I've called 911. Well, thank you, Bill. And I'm going to grab my handgun out of the instant access safe I have. And I'm going to then proceed to the stairway, and I'm going to wait till that person tries to come up, and I'm going to shoot him. And it's not because I'm afraid. It's just, it's an instinct that I've got to take action to defend my family. And I'm not mad at my neighbor if they call and tell me the bad news. So many times in my life, I've had crew members, great people, that didn't want to tell me about something bad that had happened. And over the years, I've gotten folks to stop doing that, or some of the people aren't here anymore who would keep things from me. I'm not one of these people that doesn't want to know the bad news. I want to know the whole of the truth and make preparation for it, to quote Patrick Henry. exposing the FEMA camps and that the fact that they're clandestinely setting them up is what will stop them being able to roll it out. Exposing the scariness that they admit they put fluoride in the water to lower fertility and dumb us down, that's what's getting them to remove it. Exposing the fact that under black budget programs, trillions have been siphoned off to build a parallel government. That isn't to make people think it's invincible and above the law and we can't defeat it. It's to point out it's illegitimate to bring it down. And that's what history shows happens. The elite don't want to talk about these negative things that they're doing because they want to keep us in the dark. I mean, this is all elementary. Just like politicians are told by the media and the pundits, don't get aggressive, don't be confident, don't attack your enemies, be nice, be milquetoast, have the nicest hair and the nicest tie. You know, that's not really what people are looking for. They love Donald Trump with a baseball cap on and no tie. They love the fact that he doesn't apologize. They love the fact that he is arrogant. Because they're sick of beady-eyed people like John Boehner and Obama up there BSing people. Now, before I get into the economic news and all the rest of it in detail, and before Larry Nichols, the big Clinton insider, joins us to get into what could be the fall of Hillary Clinton that we've been praying for and why that's so important, and before Gerald Celente joins us on the world economic markets, we're going to take calls as well. I wanted to get more into Trump. I've talked about Trump's background, the casinos, the giving to both parties, the fact that I don't trust him completely. That doesn't mean I'm demonizing him. Because saying the things he's saying are true and they're important debates he's triggering. The mainstream media clearly attacked him to build him up or to destroy him. I'm not sure which. It's backfired. They tried to have the Republicans and the Democrats destroy him. People are supporting him out of a protest vote. By the way, did you guys get Watson's clip? I want to play that coming up. His analysis on Trump. I sent it this morning. Good. We're going to play that coming up here in a few minutes. But also, there's something called separation of powers. And that is, we have three branches of government, knowing powerful personalities would end up battling with each other and that there would be territorial issues. That's why we have jurisdictions, so that you don't get one power that takes over everything. It's like firewalls in a building or bulkheads in a ship to stop water or fire. National sovereignty, states, counties, cities. This divides things up so we don't get one gang, one road warrior group led by the man on the white horse, humongous, to come in and say, just give me the gas, we spare your lives.
There's been too much pain. Just leave the gas, that big fat hog of a truck, and go, we spare your lives.
He sounds like a reasonable man. I'm going out there. You go out there and you get killed. That's why we have our own divide and conquer against the elites. They use it against us to keep us from getting together. But we use divide and conquer against them. And Trump might really want to be president. Trump makes his money off of a fat economy, off of service. He's service-based predominantly. And so he sees his profits going down. He thinks he could do a better job. It's good that he's a narcissist. This attack on narcissism, there's different types of it, I know. There's narcissistic rage and things like that that are real problems. But just to say that somebody, a leader, is confident and wants to build something, that message, whether he means it or not, is a true message in that the truth lives in its own statement. It doesn't even matter if a liar says it. And I'm not saying Trump's a liar. And so you've got Hillary floundering around. And you've got Trump piling on, and that was the final signal when he said she's basically a criminal, she should step down on Meet the Press, and told CNN she's got a big problem, it's criminal probe. Now Bob Woodward has come out and said that it reminds him of the Nixon tapes, and there's video of that we're going to be playing coming up in the next segment. And now there's a second server we learn about. And now Trump goes even further ahead in the polls in states where he wasn't number one. That's up on Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, and DrudgeReport.com. But let's go through the real arrogance of Hillary. I just played her, you know, basically saying that Putin is worse than Frank Underwood in House of Cards, when that character's pretty much based on Bill Clinton and Hillary, the team. I mean, that's admitted by the writers. So that's the arrogance, inverting reality yet again. Here's Hillary on her servers and on Snapchat. Again, here's her arrogance on that front.
So I am delighted to be here with you and with my fellow candidates. And I know that people across the country are following us on social media as well. By the way, you may have seen that I recently launched a Snapchat account. I love it. Those messages disappear all by themselves.
And look at the arrogance. If you're not watching us on TV, the free feed is at Infowars.com/show. Add some depth to the radio. It just augments it. And she just has a Joker-esque face. I mean, she looks more Jokerish than Jack Nicholson in Batman. She's a scary witch. Her actions are a creepy freak. Now, here's Trump on one of the Sunday news shows talking to a Clinton operative. And, you know, here they are discussing it. There's a whole bunch of these clips up on Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. And I don't even know which one to start with here, but let's just go ahead and go to him breaking this down.
Republican, why is it so?
And it doesn't matter because she did it and that's the end of it. And then her response is to be arrogant and make jokes about things disappearing off servers when they've done that with Fast and Furious, IRS Gate, all of it. Then we finally get some of the emails, and it's Lois Lerner talking about how she's going to go after Republicans. Well, of course you did. You gave one tax exemption in the last 3+ years to a conservative group and over 10,000 Democrats. The power to tax is the power to destroy. They're just shutting off their competition. Power plants that aren't on the inside, you're off. Borders open. Special interest running rampant. Special interest exempt from Obamacare. It's outrageous. Now, in fairness, I'm not normally double-minded about things, and I guess that's why they say I've been a successful talk show host, is one aspect of it is you got to be clear, you got to be concise, and not a flip-flopper. And I'm not really a flip-flopper on this. It's just, I don't like casinos. I mean, you can see some good shows there. It's not that I dislike casinos themselves. I think gambling at an industrial level is a chump's game. I mean, if you go out to a football game with your friends, want to have a bet, whatever, like to play some poker, yeah, fine. It makes the game more interesting. But when you go into these rigged events and you go along with their system, I think it's an immoral business. I'm not judging you. You can do what you want. I'm a libertarian. Doesn't mean I have to agree with it. So that's my biggest problem with Trump and some of his past activities. But we need to hold his feet to the fire, and it is pressure. You notice the Obama-Clinton operative Chuck Todd brought up, hey, conservatives say you might be a plant of the Clintons. And so then he goes after Hillary. Well, regardless, if we can make Trump, who's so popular, attack Hillary, and it helps give cover to other people to come out and attack her, because she's dangerous, then everybody can join in, and it's bye-bye Clintons. So I don't care how we get rid of them. They're a danger. They've been attacking the free press forever. It's disgusting. So here's Paul Joseph Watson's breakdown of Donald Trump. The video we're also going to tweet out at Real Alex Jones. And ask folks their take on Paul Watson's analysis. Here it is.
Donald Trump is a stooge for Hillary Clinton. He's a plant. He's a ringer to sink the chances of Republican candidates who actually have a chance of defeating Hillary.
We're a bunch of fools, and we're being led by a fool.
Hillary has already been chosen by the political elite to be the next president. Trump has no chance of defeating Hillary. That's why he's been catapulted to become the front runner in the GOP race. Shortly before Trump announced his decision to run, He received a mysterious phone call from Bill Clinton.
I didn't get a phone call from Bill Clinton before I jumped in the race. Did any of you get a phone call from Bill Clinton? I didn't. Maybe it's because I hadn't given money to the foundation or donated to his wife's Senate campaign.
As The Hill's Brent Badowski writes, if that phone call was about how Trump could act as a spoiler for the GOP race, Clinton would have told Trump to do everything that he's done since. Personally attacking other GOP candidates, alienating Hispanics, drowning out the message of new and fresh candidates. Check, check, check. Now look at the polls. Even at the height of his popularity and while Clinton is under FBI investigation, Trump trails Hillary 36-48%. He's still way behind. Whereas other GOP candidates like Scott Walker are tied in a hypothetical head-to-head with Hillary, but they're not going to get a chance to take her on. Until recently, Trump praised the Clintons, his longtime personal friends, every chance he got.
Hillary Clinton, I think, is a terrific woman. I mean, I'm a little biased because I've known her for years.
You support her?
I don't want to get into this because I'll get myself into trouble, but
I
just like her. I like her and I like her husband. Hillary's always surrounded herself with very good people. I think Hillary would do a good job.
That's not surprising given his generous donations to Clinton Senate campaigns and to the Clinton Foundation.
Actually, it was vintage Trump, you know. He has been, believe it or not, uncommonly nice to Hillary and me. He thought Hillary was a good senator for New York after 9/11.
Right.
And he's one of the many Republicans who supported our foundation before they got the memo.
Not only has Trump bankrolled Hillary, he's also supported Democrats like Chuck Schumer, Harry Reid, and Anthony Weiner, amongst others. Now look at last night's debate. Everyone is attacking Fox News, calling them biased for baiting Trump. Really? Fox just gave Trump the opportunity to do what he does best, fire back with witty retorts and turn the whole spectacle into the Donald Trump show. Trump got way more talk time than anyone else, and more than double the time that Rand Paul got. Trump is the Teflon candidate. His support only increases when he's attacked. Megyn Kelly handing Trump the chance to make politically incorrect statements only boosted his populist street cred. Notice how Fox failed to nail Trump on his key weakness, the fact that he's flip-flopped on just about every issue imaginable.
Well, I'm very pro-life and feel strongly about it.
I'm very pro-choice.
It was left to Carly Fiorina to call Trump out during the earlier debate that hardly anyone even watched.
Since he has changed his mind on amnesty, on health care, and on abortion, I would just ask, what are the principles by which he will govern?
And yes, in many ways, Trump is likable. He's a great public speaker. He makes populist statements that other politicians are afraid to say. But I think we've been down that road before, and it didn't turn out so good.
Yes, we can.
Trump's whole shtick is posing as an anti-establishment candidate, but his cozy relationship with the Clintons clearly suggests he's the opposite of that. And he's serving to eclipse the campaign of the only real anti-establishment candidate in the race, Rand Paul.
He buys and sells politicians of all stripes. He's already,
Dr. Paul.
Hey, look, he's already hedging his bet on the Clintons, okay? So if he doesn't run as a Republican, maybe he supports Clinton, or maybe runs as an independent.
Okay.
But I'd say that he's already hedging his bets because he's used to buying politicians.
Well, Trump is also the only candidate who refuses to rule out going third party, just as Ross Perot's third party run in 1992 ended up helping, you guessed it, the Clintons. The message is clear for conservatives. If you want Hillary Clinton to become the next president, then carry on supporting Donald Trump.
How do we let him get away with it, folks?
The name of that video, produced last week from the Nightly News by Paul Watson, and it makes some really good points, obviously, is Donald Trump a Hillary plant? Well, clearly, criticism on that point has made him come out more hardcore now. And people change their views over time. And I understand he wants to set up casinos in New York. He had to cozy up to Hillary Clinton. That said, I don't know how he's pro-life now when 10 years ago he was very pro-choice. See, I'd believe it if 10 years ago he was like, I don't know. I see women's right, but it's also the unborn. We ought to ban partial birth, but keep it until, you know, in the first trimester. Then I'd believe he's become more conservative. He's very slick. He's very confident. And right now it doesn't really matter because he is piling on hurting the Clintons and promoting tax cuts. The big question is, will he drop out later or run third party and deliver it to Hillary? Well, will that matter if she's been indicted? And she's being hurt by all this. She's been involved in dozens and dozens of cover-ups, but finally, it really has an effect. There's more an air of impeachment than there was back when we were trying to impeach Clinton in the late 90s. And people are just so sick of Hillary. They're so sick of the Clintons. They're so sick of the Bushes. This is not the climate to run these dinosaurs. And I think the establishment understands this is not going to fly. So I think there's some major reshuffling going on behind the scenes with the different power groups. And we're going to see some major changes. But I think there's a very good chance that Hillary may recede into the shadows if she's lucky. I think 85, 90% chance this is the end of the Clintons as we know it. We'll find out from Larry Nichols coming up in the next hour. And we'll get into the economy. Huge news on that front. Doomsday clock for global market crash strikes 1 minute to midnight. That's the London Telegraph, a lot of top experts. We'll look at that and things to do to try to stop it or mitigate it. Briefly, Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2 from InfoWarsLife.com is unlike any nascent iodine out there. It's deep earth crystal source, totally pure, you know, 9999. And it's what the body needs to block out the bad halogens like fluoride, bromine, chlorine that our environment is just saturated in. And what it's done for me and my family has been nothing less than revolutionary. It's the flagship product of InfoWarsLife.com, and we have it back in stock, available, ready to ship today to you and your family. Try it out. Just a few drops in water a day. Consult with your physician, and within a few weeks, you should start the detox. And then after that, it's just amazing response. My skin health, my stamina, my energy. It's truly amazing. InfoWarsLife.com, Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2. You can read the reviews by folks like Jay in Bronx, New York. He says, I recommend this product to everyone. After I started taking it, it was like I woke up from a dream. I haven't stopped taking it since I started. It was a life changer. Jay in Bronx, New York.
Thank you for listening to GCN.
Videos up on InfoWars.com. Bob Woodward. Clinton emails remind me of the Nixon tapes. Veteran Washington Post reporter Bob Woodward on Monday compared the email controversy engulfing Democratic presidential candidate Hillary Clinton to the downfall of President Richard Nixon. On MSNBC's Morning Joe, run by the Clintons, Woodward, who through his reporting helped break open the Watergate scandal, said it at least suspicious that the Clinton emails from her tenure as Secretary of State were wiped away from the server she owned privately. Really, you think it's suspicious? Follow the trail here, Woodward said. There are all these emails. Well, they were sent to someone or someone sent them to her. So if things have been erased here, that's a way to go back to these emails who received them from Hillary Clinton. So you've got a massive amount of data, in a way, reminds me of the Nixon tapes, thousands of hours of secret recorded conversations that Nixon thought were exclusively his. She is in a lot of trouble. News broke earlier this year that Clinton relied on a private email address and server rather than a government-owned one when she served at the State Department. And that brought down, again, the head of the EPA, who was caught with another separate email and code names, just like Hillary. So Hillary is going the way of the EPA head. Here's the clip.
Allowed to happen in the first place, and that they didn't immediately seize. We've been talking about this for a couple of days. They're all asking the same questions. Why did they allow Hillary Clinton and David Kendall, her lawyer, to decide whether they were going to turn over that classified information or not? I think this is unprecedented.
Well, it certainly is, but, I mean, follow the trail here. You know, there are all these emails. Well, they were sent to someone or someone sent them to her. So if things been erased here, there's a way to go back to who originated these emails or who received them from Hillary Clinton. So you've got a massive amount of data. It, in a way, reminds me of the Nixon tapes, thousands of hours of secretly recorded conversations that Nixon thought were exclusively hers, his, that he was not going to get them. Hillary Clinton initially took that position. I'm not turning this over. There's going to be no cooperation. Now they're cooperating, but this has to go on a long, long time. And
all right,
the answers are probably not going to be pretty.
No, they're not going to be pretty. Yeah, and they're trying to run the clock until she's president and then can pardon herself or have Obama do it. They're running the clock. And then they're not complying, though, Woodward. They gave up the servers a year after they were subpoenaed, and then they're wiped. And so the FBI raids, and those are wiped. So that's what's going on. And it's only because the government's being so embarrassed that it's having to go through the motions and dragging the feet. Because just remember, this is run by the Clintons. They run the Obama administration for all intents and purposes. But there are personalities between the Clintons, between Trump, between even Boehner, where if Boehner ever got the political cover where he's not being blackmailed, I think Boehner's probably not an evil person. I think he's probably mentally ill. Because I cry every once in a while and think about dead family or horrible things that are happening. But I don't just constantly break down like every time I'm on camera or half the time. Something's wrong with Boehner. And so we need to have him removed as the head of the House, as the Speaker of the House. We've got that whole movement we're pushing with Congressman Jones from North Carolina. Vacate the chair. That video is up on Infowars.com as well. Well, the consummate Clinton insider, the person the New York Times says Bill Clinton's afraid of, Larry Nichols, battling cancer, lung cancer, joins us on air. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We've got consummate Clinton insider Larry Nichols joining us from his home via video Skype. He is battling lung cancer and lost everything in his fight against the Clintons. He's the guy that helped make and is the key person in the Clinton Chronicles. People were killed that were involved in that film. More than 150 people were Arkansided in the state of Arkansas, or now the state of Arkansas as it's known. And the Clinton's medical examiner would certify people with their arms and legs cut off in trash bags as suicide. Of course, that's impossible. And he has been warning of what Hillary would do all along and giving us the inside scoop, LarryNichols.com. He's going to be joining us, but before we talk to him about could this be the fall of Hillary, what's he really think about Donald Trump, who previously said he loves Hillary? Now he says she should step down and not run for office. Is he double-crossing her? Or is the fix in to cover up the other candidates? Or he runs third party and mainly conservatives vote for him because he's balkanized Democrats and minorities not to vote for him, and then he delivers 2016 to Hillary? We're going to find out. I don't know his answer yet, but I respect Larry Nichols' take. I've been interviewing Larry Nichols since 1996. So Larry Nichols joins us here in a moment. Former State House whistleblower, government insider, served as a political confidant, advisor to Bill Clinton for more than 10 years and helped Bill Clinton get elected and reelected as governor of Arkansas. And that's admitted in the New York Times that Clinton, quote, is afraid of Larry Nichols. Mr. Nichols is unrestrained by political correctness and was specifically mentioned by Bill Clinton in his memoir. And, of course, he knew well and worked with a lot of the other big Clinton operatives that are famous as well and can speak to that whole situation. But before we do that, here's some of Hillary's arrogance trying to put on the face that she's invincible. Again, here she is last Friday making jokes about Snapchat that automatically erases the videos. It's mainly used for folks to send each other, you know, sex videos. And then implying that, ha-ha, you know, she erased the emails, to which her constituents praise the Nixonian activity. Here it is.
So I am delighted to be here with you and with my fellow candidates. And I know that people across the country are following us on social media as well. By the way, You may have seen that I recently launched a Snapchat account. I love it. I love it. Those messages disappear all by themselves.
And the Joker-esque smile, the evil smile, could be the cover of a supervillain movie. I mean, she really is a piece of work. Here she is, a week after they'd killed Gaddafi and drug him to the street. The country failed. Al-Qaeda took over. They now admit it's the worst place in Africa. Women have been enslaved. Tens of thousands of blacks have been killed by the racist Islamicists. And they go, oh, it was an accident. No, they wanted to fail the country and break it into multiple parts, which they're now doing. So here she is bragging about she came, she saw, she conquered, he died, quoting Julius Caesar.
So, I mean, that is the land of unconfirmed reports.
Yes, we came, we saw, he died.
Did it have anything to do with your visit?
No, I'm sure it did.
You know, there's nothing sicker than a woman that probably couldn't deadlift 100 pounds bragging about killing somebody with other foppish, sycophantic women. And I'm not attacking women themselves, but I know a lot of former special forces, current special forces, Delta Force, Army Rangers, Navy SEALs. I've had a lot of family in black ops. I've had family that were on international hit teams, stuff like that. They never talk about any of it. And if they hear somebody, and it's unbecoming when I have flashbacks talking about fistfights or something, it's not manly in that circle to just tell stories. But I tell stories about my experiences all the time. Shocking stuff, funny stuff. I mean, I just what I do. I tell you what I'm thinking. No teleprompters here, just stream of consciousness. But it's unbecoming even me as a man to shoot my mouth off sometimes. Even though I'm the first person to tell you I've had my butt kicked. I've been in the hospital with a bone sticking out of my leg. I mean, let me tell you, I could fight and fight hard. Let me tell you, a lot of other men can too. So I don't claim to be the baddest guy around. What I do claim is you get in a fight with me, you're going to get attacked 110%, so good luck. But to have Hillary Clinton, who's done nothing but order a lot of killings, it's really gross. You know, Larry Nichols has been in black ops and secret operations for the government. He won't talk about it, but it's been admitted by the New York Times. He I'm sure won't say anything about it. To have Hillary constantly bragging about killing people and constantly laughing like the Joker when the woman can't even probably push her own grocery cart. It's just so icky. And so disgusting to know what a gangster she is and that she constantly brags about it. And she goes after her political enemies. And this is just a really unseemly group of people that have never even gotten their hands dirty. And they are just manifestly archetypally evil. They're absolutely out of control. And I can't believe this nation is run by them. What does it say about us? And the type of people that the ruling financial elites want in power, who they can destroy anytime they want. And are we reaching that point with different power groups getting ready, sick of the Clintons throwing their weight around, blackmailing powerful people? Are we nearing the end of Hillary and Bill Clinton? Bill Clinton looks like he's dying. I mean, you know, Larry Nichols has got lung cancer, is on chemotherapy. He looks pretty healthy. Even though you tell he's lost a lot of weight, we're about to go to him video Skype. You can watch it at Infowars.com/show. But sitting here looking at Clinton play golf last weekend at Martha's Vineyard, he looks like a reanimated corpse. So does the system know that the fall of the Clintons is upon us? Could that great day be actually here? And I'll tell you, I got some self-interest in this. They've tried to kill Larry Nichols. They've killed a bunch of people in Arkansas, including folks that were in the film. The Clinton Chronicles 1 and 2, a lot of them got beat up, you name it. I'm on their enemies list. I've been messed with by the Clintons, specifically on Waco, and I was getting physically attacked by five guys once in a parking lot. They said, shut up about Waco and the Clintons. I was fired from my first big hit radio job, number one in the city. I was told, stop talking about the Clintons. And I wouldn't. They said, you're fired. And they were told, do not talk about the Clintons. So they... I'm sick of these bullies is what I'm getting at. Larry, I'm ranting. LarryNichols.com. Thank you for joining us for the first time via video Skype. Good to have you. Hope you get better, buddy. We're praying for you. You heard my whole rant about Hillary. What do you have to say about that? And are we at the point of the fall of the Clintons?
Well, first off, you pointed out lung cancer, and that'll sick them on me big time. But we'll leave it at not quite lung cancer, but whatever. They're going to come at me any way they can. And we've been trying to keep it kind of down. But let me tell you something, Alex. These people will get you. You know they will. I don't have to tell you. Good Lord.
Sure, sure. I mean, I get what you're saying, though. To be clear, if you already are sick, then they could whack you and claim you just died of that.
Exactly. That's right. That gives them a legitimate way for me just to disappear and say, oh, bless his heart. He, you know, you just have to be careful with these guys. If you know what I know, Alex, the list goes on and on. People don't realize it, but let's see. The guy, the cameraman for the Clinton Chronicles, dead. 50-some-odd people that I worked with that were fixing to testify against Hillary in court for Whitewater, dead. I mean, you're talking about guys that get up on the roof. I think it's in Kansas City, get up on the roof, jump off the roof and kill yourself, which is fine. I can live with that. The problem is you couldn't get through that door except from the outside. How do you do it? So it's loaded with that kind of stuff. Now, I guess more importantly today, what's going on with Hillary? One of two things is happening, Alex, right now. Either Hillary and her campaign with Bill, they're either getting this stuff out now on purpose, because one of the rules we have when you run for office, Alex, is you got to be the underdog. Where she screwed up the last time running against Obama, she came in as this anointed one that was going to be guaranteed to get it. That's against the system. This time she's doing it right. This time she went out, she cleared the field. You're going to notice there's nobody running against her, except what's his name, the socialist. She drew down all the money out there. So if somebody does get in, where are they going to get the money? She's playing the system exactly. Now, at this point, I'm going to tell you one of two things is going on, Alex. Either this is the Clintons getting this out so that she becomes, one, the underdog, which she has to do to win, or two, she's got Obama. Remember what we said last time, Alex, the best friends we got in this country are Bill and Hillary Clinton right now. Because, as you know, Obama would love nothing better than to have some strikes, riots all around the country. And then he gets to bring in and kick in the FEMA provisional government, which we know to be martial law. And then he's king. Well, there's only two people powerful enough to stop him, and that's Bill and Hillary. So I wonder if this new impetus that's being put on these emails is coming from Obama to take them out of the game. And I guess there is a third one. All of this that we're seeing might be real. It'd be the first time we've seen anything having to do with the Clintons or national politics that's real. So that's where we stand. But I can assure you this. I don't believe the emails will get Hillary. As I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, Alex, I think the emails that they have found that have been top secret are not slated top secret on her server. Now, if that's the case, if they don't say top secret, she's held harmless. Prove anything you want. You're not going to get her. But we've got something that I gave you, which is probably not a favor to you. But we've got a document that I have, the original of, that will get her and get her bad. And it's going to be broken today. We're going to put it out, I hope, if you choose to.
Yes, we have. It's the memo on Vince Foster.
It is indeed. Now, folks, what that memo says, and I know it's hard to read, the bottom line to that memo, it says the body of Vincent Foster, White House chief counsel, was found in his car in the Fort Morrissey Park parking lot with a wound to his head. 38 caliber revolver was found in the car with him, along with a six-pack of Arnold and James wine coolers, of which he had drank one. The others were not open. Then it also says in the back seat, the magic briefcase is there. Now, guys, see that number bottom right down there? What is that? Alex, I can't see from here, that 620
Yes.
60, well, no, I'm sorry. Look at the top of this. Look at the top of it. 2551. There it is. Now, folks, that means this document right here. I placed that in Kenneth Starr's evidentiary file. There it is. That's the official evidentiary stamp. Now, how did this, Alex, go untalked about? I mean, we're not talking, Alex, about a typo error. Look at that. It speaks with specificity. Vince Foster, they say, the Park Police, and they told the Secret Service at the White House. This is the first notification to the Secret Service that Vince Foster had been found. The story, as we're told, is he walked, got out of his car in that parking lot, walked 200 yards on a dirt trail, went to a berm, sat down by a Civil War cannon, stuck a pistol in his mouth, and shot himself in the head. Now, when you look at the autopsy, it's odd. You know, Alex, that man walked 200 yards on a dirt trail in the hot of July and didn't get a microscopic speck of dust on his shoes, pants, socks, belt, nowhere. The only thing they found on him were multicolor, long, shag carpet fibers. Why is this important? I guess the audience is wondering. This is old news, Ms. Foster's dead. Well, no. No. Right there, Alex, you have in your hand the evidence that Hillary's been afraid of. That's why they're afraid of me.
And that's why they told the New York Times they're afraid of you. Is this the first time this Secret Service memo has been seen?
Yes, sir. I waited and held it out here. The National Enquirer was going to do a story on it, but I kept holding them down. This is it. This is where it comes, right here. And Alex,
how were you able to get this and give this to the special prosecutor from the Clinton impeachment?
I stole it. I just stole it. I stole it from the FBI guys that had got it. And I got it before Starr did, and I put it in the file. That's the real deal. There's nothing fake about that, folks. You can go to the
library. Now, you're covering for the FBI agents, aren't you? You were given this memo.
Yeah. Well, let me take that back because I don't get them in trouble. My mailbox got that. Just one day I woke up and there was a mailbox of mine and that was in it, along with a whole bunch of other documents. Alex, when we get through, you and I, if you want to, it's your call, of course. This stuff's important because there's no statute of limitations on murder.
No, dump it all. We've already gotten enough trouble. We might as well sign our John Hancock's big.
I'm going to dump it all, and I'm going to dump it right here. But I hope y'all forgive me for one little thing. With all the pain the Clintons have caused people, with all the lying and all the hurting and all the people. Now, remember, I'm not saying Bill and Hillary have killed a soul, not them. I'm not saying they've even ordered it. But I do know, as do you, Alex, more people died around Bill and Hillary Clinton than any other president in history. In history, even in wartime presidents. And she just announces she's running. What do you find, Alex? You find their chef back in that day goes to New Mexico, goes on a hike, then they find him drowned. Starting all over again. And
they're tying up loose ends. Larry Nichols, big time Clinton insider, the guy behind the Clinton Chronicles, all the big stories. And the guy that they just said last year they're afraid of, obviously, and we need to pray for him because he is on chemotherapy. You might have forgotten. You did kind of halfway announce it last time you were on, so I wasn't.
But
I understand you don't want to talk about how sick you are, but you look pretty good, so we're praying for you, buddy. But I want to shift gears back to her then. Why does she love to brag about killing people? I mean, you heard me make the whole point about how unseemly that is. Before we go back into Vince Foster, the 3 points. Trump could be for real. This could all be really happening. The country's fed up. The power structure's sick of the Clintons. Even Bob Woodward's come out and said it looks like, you know, Nixon. Or, and I thought of this too, but never said it on air, this could be Obama getting rid of his political controllers so he can go for the big power grab instead of letting them have their shot. And it could be the camp that backs Obama, and he has been double-crossing with the Islamicists, the Saudi Arabians. He clearly has a bigger power play here, like nothing I've ever seen. And so could he be planning something and to not pardon the Clintons? Could he be getting ready to set them up?
You know, Alex, I've feared this since day one. You know, we're at a point in history with the United States of America.
We're in the end game, so they're going to start stabbing each other in the back.
That's right. And everybody is vying to be the last president, because then when this country falls, the last president becomes essentially a king. The FEMA provisional government, which you've talked about, Alex, for years.
And by the way, Putin's done that. He's the last president in Russia.
He is. So what they're doing is we're in a power struggle for the one that's going to be the last president, who then therefore becomes king. Virtually the Euro-style 16th century type government. And so, yeah, that's why I think about Obama. Of course I do. He knows what I know. He knows Bill and Hillary will move on him, stop him if they can. And I believe he wants it, and I believe Obama is moving to take over this country, be king. And the minute he gets it, Alex, this is conjecture on my part, but I believe the minute he gets that, what's going to happen is he's going to open up and say, I'm really a Muslim, and we are now an Islamic caliphate.
Then let me expand on that. Could Trump be working for Obama to knock out Hillary and to basically get all this prepared and set up?
I think, in my way of looking, there's two things Trump can be doing. Number one, he can be a ringer for Hillary. He is following eerily exactly the pattern they used with Ross Perot. And I've got the state troopers that were Clinton security guards of that day, and they talk and have gone public telling that every day Bill Clinton and Ross Perot talked when they were supposedly running against each other. So he could be setting Hillary up. Or you know what? He could be real. He could be real. And I guess you could look at the third, that he might be working for Obama, but I've never heard Trump in anything that I can recall. Maybe you have. I haven't heard anything he said that I can recall that would ingratiate him with Obama.
No, I agree with you, except he helped push the whole Kenya birth certificate deal when we actually know he's the son of Frank Marshall Davis. And that whole story, they wanted us to say he was from Kenya. It's why they said when he was the head of the Harvard Review, Law Review, that he was born there. His wife said it in speeches. They put out a fake birth certificate on purpose. We buy it. Trump pushes the birth certificate. And the truth is, he's the son of a famous communist pornographer who he admits he lived with as a kid. I mean, it's just, you see how these intelligence operatives operate. Bottom line, things are shaking up big time. Larry Nichols is going to give you the data dump on what was really in the impeachment of Clinton, round one. And is this the fall of the Clintons, or a power struggle between Obama and the Clintons, or could Trump be working for Jeb Bush? Who knows? We got to look at every angle. The truth is, the words we speak do go on forever as long as humans keep records of it. And that's our connection to the past and the future. Larry Nichols is our guest. That was not a mistake earlier, and Larry's agreed that I can talk about it. And I want to talk about it especially so you can get some real support and try to stay alive longer, because he's exhausted his estate. He is battling lung cancer. Same thing killed his dad. He said he knows that they can kill him in the hospital. They've tried to kill him before. He says every time they come in with the injections, you know, he puckers. Hoping that it isn't his last, because they love to do that. Look, they already have databases. They already know what's wrong with him. It came out last time briefly. And so I think it's more important than ever we pray for Larry Nichols. And he didn't ask us to do this, but I'm going to do it. Let's put up his P.O. box here on screen whenever we get a chance. And we will give people that P.O. box so that you can donate to him so he can get some good medical care. He lost his career so much more when he was at the heights of state government working for the Clintons, because he wouldn't be part of the narcotics trafficking. So when we do get that P.O. box up on screen, I will give you that address. so that you can do that. But it is so important that we stand up and that we support folks that have told the truth, that have taken action. And again, we'll put it on screen for TV viewers later in the broadcast. I can bring Larry Nichols up and he can verbally give us his address on air so that he can get some treatment. He does have cancer, advanced cancer, and we just want to pray for him and keep him alive as long as possible, and good medical care could do that. Larry, I mean, it's out there, so we should get it out there all the way, because I agree with you, it's dangerous, obviously, but we need to get it out there. What is your P.O. box for folks that want to support you?
I don't have a P.O. box. I've got my address, number 68, Kensington Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034. And because of your program, I had a PayPal thing set up. I don't know much about it, but you can go to PayPal, and it's NicholsLive@AOL.com. And Alex, you know, I don't want anybody thinking that what I'm saying is just about money.
I know, you never even asked for it. And then when you were on a few months ago, I said, how are you doing? You said, I'm broke. I got cancer. Yeah. Same way my dad went. And I just want to be able to live long enough to try to see these people go down. And so I said, let's put your home address out, or your address to folks who support you. Then I told you, you should get a PayPal so you can get, you know, better donations that way. People can go to LarryNichols.com and link through on there and find your address and more. LarryNichols.com. Now, I want to do the data dump here on the Clintons. That's really important, but I appreciate your courage to talk about this. But do you want to tell folks medically where you're at?
No, not really, but I'll say this, folks. Please don't worry. I'll be alive long enough, Alex, to get them. I know they don't want to hear that. But you've got my word, folks. I'm not going anywhere, nowhere, until we stop this madness. And
you know, what about Bill? How does he look to you?
Like you said, death warmed over. I mean, I know I look hollowed out, and I know I look bad. But my God, Bill looks like he's already been dead. And you're exactly right. But we will stay the course. This is coming. And the thing about the documents that we're going to be laying out to you, Alex, this stuff's real. This stuff, they can't get rid of it. We've got this evidence. And like I said, guys, there's no statute of limitation on murder. And suicide is murder. The reason it got covered up in the first place, folks, so, you know, why would they go to the trouble to move the body, even if he did kill himself? It's because had they not have moved his body, where he died would have fallen under the D.C. police, and they would have surely have gotten to the part that Hillary and Vince had a longstanding affair. And had that have come out, then Hillary wouldn't be running for president now. They had to cover it up, and they had to move it into the Park Police jurisdiction, which gave them the cover.
Sure, the Clintons were about to fall because of all this in 95, and then magically Oklahoma City took place right next door to your state in Oklahoma. And Clinton told on Air Force One, the whole press corps, as you know, 1 year later that he owed his reelection to Oklahoma City.
While you're talking, let me go let that damn dog out, or you're not going to hear me at all.
I understand. Go ahead. Hey, bring the dog on screen. We want to see it.
He's an English bulldog, and he's stubborn. He's kind of like his master, a little bit of a stubborn bulldog. All right. I'll be right.
All right. All right. He just unplugged his mic. What a character Larry Nichols is. We are going to send a crew up there to interview Larry Nichols. I've been a little short of manpower, but I do want to send Josh Owens and Jakari Jackson or whoever else wants to go up to Arkansas to interview Larry Nichols. That needs to happen sooner rather than later. And again, I wasn't throwing him under the bus, folks. He had mentioned the cancer, said it last time he was on, and then once it started coming out, I'm like, Larry, you got to go ahead and just say it all. And he's like, yeah, but the Clintons will know. I mean, obviously the Clintons already know.
They've got, I'm back. That was embarrassing. But that is not.
It's real radio. It makes it even better. / TV. Okay, in the 20 minutes we've got left, or 25 minutes, I'll hold you into the next segment after that. Let's get into the data dump. I mean, this is a big deal that the prosecution of Clinton in the House and Senate, well, that they voted to start the investigation and the trial in the Senate, in the House, and then you have the fact that Vince Foster's in the car. They've obviously had the Park Police and others drag him off. Why were they trying to cover that up, and how could they cover it up? It's so obvious.
Well, again, the reason they covered it up was simply to keep the fact that Hillary would be then, if they'd have stayed in the D.C. police, there's no doubt the affair between Vince and Hillary would come up as a mitigating circumstance. That would have meant Hillary would have been the first lady in history to be caught having an affair. Now, today, Alex, that might not have that kind of impact, but it would have been devastating back then. You know, we've dropped so far in our morals that I don't even know what matters now. But I promise you, that would have been devastating then. And so what they're doing is they're trying to keep that under the cover. That's why they're afraid of me. They know what I've got. Let me give another example of what I possess. The autopsy report, folks, guarantees you metaphysically that Vince Foster didn't die the way they said he did. When the medical examiner went over and did the autopsy, they found whole meat and potatoes in his stomach. I don't mean to be gross. That's significant because it takes 3 hours approximately, and I don't mean approximately like it could be 5 hours. I mean, it's 3 hours, maybe 3.5 hours tops. But the body turns whole food into a liquid form, and that's how it's digested and sent through the system. So we know from Linda Tripp that she got him a hamburger and french fries, and he took it from her between 12:15 and 12:30. So if you extrapolate, that means he had to have died. His life had to have ended before 3 or 3:30 in the afternoon. It was 94 to 96 degrees that day in Washington. Now, imagine, and he didn't get found, by the way, folks, until 6:15. 6:15 is the first time the medical examiners laid eyes on him, and they made two comments that were significant. They said, well, he didn't look dead. You know, he didn't look dead. Well, let me tell you, anybody that has seen roadkill on the highway will know. If you lay out in the hot sun for 3 hours, it's going to be bloat city. It's going to bloat up. The gases are going to build up. They didn't in him. The next thing they said, which is really weird, they said they put their hands in his pocket looking for the car keys. As you can imagine, Alex, somebody that's been out there in that hot sun, you couldn't, it looked like his britches are painted on him. You're not going to get your hands in his pocket. Now, they also, and this is the first responders, they said there was no blood at the scene. There was just a little trickle coming out his nose that went down on his shirt pocket. Well, Alex, you've been around. I know you have seen head wounds in suicide. It's not a pleasant thing to see. But one thing that happens when you receive a head wound like that, there is a lot of blood. There was no blood on the ground. They didn't find anything. It looked like he had just fallen asleep.
Well, clearly they covered up what really happened to him. Do you believe he committed suicide or was murdered? If he just committed suicide, why cover it up?
Well, the reason to cover it up was to keep that from getting out about the affair. That's all it was. You know, when I was with Bill, you know, that was one of the problems we always had. We could take something that looks bad, but if you just leave it alone, Alex, it'll go away. But we always had a problem with Bill forcing it. They were so busy trying to cover stuff up that they'd make it worse. They should have left it alone. The reason they didn't is because a man named Eric Glasscock found out from me, and we found out that Vince Foster and Larry Wallace, an attorney here in Arkansas, big friend of Bill's, and with Vince, they had rented a house from the old Louisiana senator who had retired. He still had the house. They rented that for a cat house for Bill to slip away from the White House and have his parties. Now, that house, if you walked out on the back porch and you threw a rock, if you could throw a rock 100 yards, you'd hit the berm where they found him, straight line, hit the berm. When I went to visit that house, just to check it out, and this was very soon after the death, I get there, and to my chagrin, there's a carpet-laying truck there. I go up, and I said, buddy, you're replacing the carpet. He said, yeah, there's a room we've got to replace the carpet in. I said, well, can I see the carpet? He said, well, that's weird. The carpet's already gone. They'd already taken it up. But then he led me into the room, and he said, but I tell you what's crazy. Look at this. And in the middle of the room, it looked like somebody bled a hog out. But they had taken the carpet. So I'm going, well, I guess that.
So he shot himself in the whore pad, and they had to cover that up because they didn't want an investigation of the whorehouse.
That's right. They didn't want it by the D.C. police. Remember, that's the key thing. The park police, as you know, Alex.
That's right. They're always finding the dead interns drug onto the parkland.
Yeah.
That way and they can cover it up.
The park police have been the fixtures for politicians for years and years and years. So I go in. There's the stain in the floor, obviously. And I say to the guy, well, God, I wish there'd have been some of that carpet I needed. He said, well, I don't tell you what kind of carpet it was. Now, folks, this is his exact words. Come over here, and he looked at the tacking strip. He said, look, pulled up a piece of it. He said, it's long, multicolored shag carpet. Exactly what matches the autopsy. Exactly. But remember, don't worry about that. It's all in the documents that we have. That autopsy report, Alex, is a killer. It's a killer because now you're dealing with science, metaphysics. They can call me a liar. They can call you a liar. They can do whatever, but that's the autopsy report. So when that comes out, we'll break it out of here. And the point to all of this is the American people need to hear the truth about the real Hillary Clinton.
Well, Larry, I'm going to say this right now. It is amazing having you via video Skype. Your phone quality is not good. I would like to invite you up later this week to really go over even more, just bam, bam, bam. When we come back, though, I really want to specifically get in to what else you think they're going to pull, where you think they're going. What does your gut tell you? Is this Obama waging war against the Clintons, or is Trump for real? Because if he was a shill for Hillary, saying she's a crook and should step down, that's something that even if he flip-flops later is damaging her. I don't see him making statements like that if he's still under her control. What do you think?
Well, I think there's a chance Trump's real. I hope he's real. But now, Alex, you want me to burst everybody's bubble about Trump?
Go ahead.
Remember, guys, the reason the Clintons had me around was because I was a pretty good old country strategist when it came to politics. Now, I want all of you to take Donald Trump's numbers, take Carla Fiorini's numbers, take Ben Carson's numbers, and take Rand Paul's numbers. Add those up, and come primary day in the RNC primary, that's what Trump's going to end up with. Now, let's take another candidate, for example, Papa Jen.
Stay there. Explain to us the numbers from political strategy. Again, you're one of the admitted brain experts on Clinton's successful gubernatorial runs and one of his fixers until it got into narcotics trafficking and you wouldn't be part of it. Larry Nichols is our guest. I can't believe it's deja vu. We're back to battling the Clintons. They just never go away like herpes. I'm Alex Jones. Stay with us. We're going to find out exactly what political strategist Larry Nichols, who worked side by side with other Clinton top strategists who are household names, we're going to find out exactly why he thinks Trump is basically going to burst all our bubbles. And is it what a lot of people look at the polls and say, that Rand Paul is a better shot at beating Hillary than Trump, and Trump has alienated Democrat voters? We're going to find out in just a moment from Larry Nichols of LarryNichols.com. I want to put on screen, if you want to correspond to him or you want to try to send him $5, $10, whatever, he's not asking for it, but I know he's broke and battling cancer. Larry Nichols, 58, Kensington Drive. That's K-E-N-S-I-N-G-T-O-N Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034. Or link through to his PayPal at LarryNichols.com. And he could be right there with the Clintons today. I mean, he was their big confidant, but he would not be part of the death of teenagers that saw the drug dealing, the flying the drugs in. He just wouldn't be part of it. Briefly, Supermel Vitality, that is a whole bunch of organic, concentrated, that's the key word, herbs known to supercharge your glands on production and to block estrogen mimickers. And all I can say is you're supposed to take it under your tongue. I forget to do it, just take two or three squirts a day. It's a little more than you're supposed to take. And put it in water. I do it at lunch, like I'm doing right now. And then every couple days, I don't do it every day because I just go ahead and take a full squirt. You're supposed to take less than that a day. I just do it every few days. I take the X2. And I had a spoon here. Here it is. The Nation Iodine from InfoWarsLife.com that blocks the bad halogens and does so much good for your glands on record. And I drink it and it tastes great. Like, I've gotten addicted to the taste. And it just supercharges me, more energy, healthier skin, so many things. And I'm not some beautiful beach boy, but I've lost 65 pounds in the last few years, gotten a lot healthier. And it's been a game changer in your purchase of these amazing nutraceuticals. There's 14 different ones we developed now. InfoWarsLife.com funds this operation. Here's what James in Toronto, Canada had to say. Improved quality of my life, well worth the money. I would recommend it. Supermel Vitality. Here's another one. This is from Sweet Lou in Connecticut. Just finishing my first bottle. I've already ordered and received my second bottle. I am using this with several other products, drinking purified water. I quickly felt the difference in my energy levels and alertness, especially at the end of the day when I would normally be more tired than I am now. Yeah, sometimes I got to go work at like midnight on some like coast to coast. I'll just drink a bunch of it. Very impressed with products sold by InfoWars. I would normally be more tired than I am now. Well, thank you. And that's just the latest. There's still over 500 reviews on third-party review site right there at InfoWarsLife.com. Larry, we got a final 5 minutes coming up. And as usual, you and I are both from the South. We babble a lot. We talk over each other. We tell stories in detail. What's the other big dirt that you've got on the Clintons? Obviously, we need to get this out quickly, so we should get you back on the next few days via video Skype. I want to thank you for hooking it up. But briefly, tell us what's coming up in the next final segment. Go ahead and get it out there. What's the other intel you got on the Clintons?
Well, the most important thing, of course, is the autopsy. But the other stuff that I've got coming out has to do with Alaskan fisheries. Alaskan fisheries. Now, if you don't think that's important, folks, it got Ron Brown killed. Ron Brown, the Secretary of Commerce. Alex, the stuff is there. When Vince Foster died, it was all there the whole time. Kenneth Starr claimed to me that he wasn't going to get into if he wasn't murdered.
Hold on, back in 70 seconds. This is Bombshell. I'm going right to you. 70 seconds.
Thank you.
Larry Nichols. Then we've got the economic breakdown.
Visit
coming up with Gerald. All right, Larry Nichols, we got 5 minutes left. I want to invite you back up on Thursday or Friday, if you can do it, sir, to really get into more of this and take phone calls. Clinton Insider joining us. Finish up. You got 5 minutes. Also, get into Trump. You never had a chance to talk about that, how he can burst our bubble. Go ahead.
Well, the Ron Brown is going to be significant. By the way, back to the autopsy of Vince Foster. Folks, you got to realize the doctor that did the autopsy, they brought him out of retirement, Alex. That guy did the autopsy on John F. Kennedy. He was retired. And they brought him out of retirement to conduct the autopsy on Vince Foster, number one. Now, back to Ron Brown. When Ron Brown died, he had come out saying, I had broken a story about Alaskan fisheries where Ron Brown had said Alaskan fishery had come up with this boat that could catch fish and process fish at the same time on the boat. Ron Brown passed an order and said it was illegal to do that, so they had to stop catching fish and processing them on the boat. But when he did that, Alaskan fishery stock plummeted to like, God, 25 cents a share from $8 or $9 a share. Well, Clinton, longtime friend and supporter, Don Tyson, goes in and buys out Alaskan Fisheries stock, all of it. 30 days after he buys it, Ron Brown changes the ruling and makes it okay now again to do, to, you know, to process the fish on the same ship that catches them. Now, when that happened, I mean, this is a huge profit for Tyson. Well, I got hold of it and I started pressing on it. Now, the media actually got hold of that and started querying Ron Brown. And it looked like we were getting some congressional investigations.
And Brown said, if I go down, everybody goes down.
You got it, Alex. When he said that, I think you and I talked about it. I said, he won't be around long or something.
We did. We did.
Well, then he goes on a junket into Germany and his plane flies into the side of a mountain. Well, folks, here's where that story gets weird. I had two captains or majors that came to me from the Air Force that actually did the autopsy.
They were the one that released it to the Washington Times, if I remember, where they did the unofficial one when the intake, and he had a bullet hole in his head, right? A 45?
Exact bullet hole in the top of his head, exactly the size of a 45 caliber bullet, which is what the military carried in that day. And then there was a stewardess, which she was really a sergeant, Sergeant Kelly. When they got to the crash site, folks, she was sitting on a stump crying. She walked to the helicopter. And as you remember, Alex, when she landed at the base with the helicopter, she's dead on arrival. They showed me the x-ray. And that lady's brain stem had been completely severed.
Special Forces broke her neck. We're out of time. I want to have you back in a couple of days if you can do it to take calls and flesh more of this out. Bombshell, thank you for your courage. Briefly, what's the problem with Trump? He doesn't go as well against Hillary in a general election?
He doesn't go well at all, because what's going to happen in the primary, that's where they'll beat him. But there's stuff we need to talk about that. What he says when he says he's not going to swear he won't switch to an independent is because of the dirty tricks that he knows the RNC will pull on him and get him kicked out of the race in 5 or 6 states, and therefore he can't win. That's what he's saying. If they pull those stunts, he will switch parties. And Alex, by the way, we don't have enough time but to tell all the dirty tricks, but there is a company, because of the last show I did with you, they're putting out The Genie's Out of the Bottle, which is simply a book that tells you all of the tricks. And it's listenupaudiobooks.com. They're doing it. I'm not. You need to get that book, and it'll tell you, Alex, play by play, what Hillary's doing right now and what she'll do in the future.
Well, it's great having you via video Skype, and I'm going to send the crew up. I'm going to not procrastinate. I'm going to have Rob Duke call you, if it's okay, in about 15 minutes, give you a break. Okay. And I want to send a crew up to just let you dump it all on us, show the documents, everything up there to Arkansas, okay?
You bet. Alex, thank you, my friend.
Thank you, Larry, and we're praying for you. Everybody say a prayer. Larry Nichols, a real patriot exposing evil. We appreciate you, buddy. We'll be back with our next guest on the World Financial Meltdown. Joining us is Gerald Celente, one of our most popular guests, a good friend of mine. And I want to cover the waterfront from Donald Trump to Hillary Clinton to Japan nuclear utility, reactivating a nuclear reactor, and 1 month after they turned it on, the first new one to be turned on, they turned them all off since the Fukushima disaster 4 years ago, and a volcano started erupting right next to it. That's in Reuters. I shouldn't laugh. It's not funny. The winds blow this way. Also, new report, massive immigration surge from Mexico. Latin America is continuing to degenerate and fall apart. There's a worldwide depression. Africa's collapsing. The Middle East is in turmoil. And they're telling us everything's wonderful here. Greece has got big problems. We're going to cover all of that. I haven't gotten to this yet, too. I want to get Gerald Celente's take on the attempt to stir up racial problems in the country, clearly by the White House. We've got two white sorority videos slammed for being racially homogeneous, but only because it's white and homogeneous. It's okay for any other group to be in a group. I mean, it's just amazing how they push this. Black Lives Matter activists wiped their butts with Confederate flag. Group waved communist flags during their confrontation. This is like all these fake, phony victories that political correctness gives people, where you obsess over stuff that doesn't matter, and then all of our basic freedoms are being taken. Our dollar's being devalued. We're being spied on. We've got the IRS persecuting people. Nixon got in trouble. Good. But what Hillary and others have done is much worse. It's just incredible. So that's all coming up. But the main reason I wanted to get Gerald Celente on with us is because he has been accurately predicting for a decade that by 2014, 2015, we would see a world financial meltdown. It's looking at derivatives, the trends. Because here, when the dollar's devalued or currencies are devalued, it just means you can't go on as many vacations, even if you're working class or whatever. You have trouble paying your bills. When you start spending 50% or more of your discretionary income on food, as they do in most of the world, riots start. All hell breaks loose. And now we see this headline out of the London Telegraph: doomsday clock for global market crash strikes 1 minute to midnight as central banks lose control. That's not Infowars.com. That's not TrendsResearch.com. We said it before, of course. That's the London Telegraph. China currency devaluation signals endgame, which is exactly what our guests have said the last week, is leaving the equity markets free to collapse under the weight of impossible expectations. Yes. False earnings. Overvalued stocks. Huge debts. Derivatives. When the banking crisis crippled global markets 7 years ago, central bankers stepped in as leaders of last resort, of lenders. Profligate private sector loans were moved onto the public sector balance sheet. And vast money printing gave the global economy room to heal. No, room for it to be even worse. Rats chewed our legs off, so they just gave us morphine. Time is now rapidly running out. From China to Brazil, the central banks have lost control. At the same time, the global economy is grinding to a halt. It is only a matter of time before stock market collapses under the weight of their lofty expectations and record valuations and the $2.2 quadrillion we've been signed on to that isn't our debt. The FTSE 100 has now erased its gains for the year, but there are signs things could get a whole lot worse. So people say, well, a correction of 10-20% is not a big deal globally because it's overvalued. But even the overvaluation can't prop up the derivatives and the debt. Do you understand? So if they cut interest rates anymore, it's impossible because they're already zero. It causes inflation. If they don't, it causes the economy to shut down even faster. And then this excellent article goes over it all. The difference is Gerald Celente, Dr. Paul Craig Roberts, who works with him at the Trends Journal, former Wall Street Journal editor, the editor, former head of policy at the Treasury for Reagan, has been saying the same thing. Mr. Dent's been saying the same thing. Schiff's been saying the thing. We have the guest on. There's not many of them, but we have them, who are more accurate than mainstream media. Mainstream media is trying to deceive the public while they themselves run to the hills and dig in like all hell's about to break loose. Here's another article. Ron Paul, Fed may not hike because everything is vulnerable. Did you know that the U.S. no longer has any strategic grain reserves at all? That's a Michael Snyder report, Economic Collapse blog, Infowars.com. Greek government on its last legs while Angela Merkel faces growing rebellion in Berlin. Yeah, because no amount of bailouts will fix the debt. It's just more to the very bankers. We loan them the money to bail them out, and then we're in debt to them. So that's some of the news on the economic front. I've got a whole nother stack we'll go over with Gerald Celente, but Gerald, everything seems to be spiraling out of control. Escalations in military operations, trying to topple Assad for ISIS, escalating military conflict with Russia on its border. This is the stuff we saw before World War I and World War II. As you said, when the economy goes down, they take you to war, historically, to divert attention so the crooks don't go to jail. Hillary is on the verge of maybe getting indicted. Woodward signals this by saying it's Nixonian and it's not going to look good when it comes out. Trump now turns against her. What do you think's going on, Gerald Celente?
Well, on the economic front, I mean, you really summed it up because it all ties together. I think you began with these immigration wave coming over. And when you go south of the border, even below Mexico way, it's currency crisis after currency crisis, commodity crash after commodity crash. Current events form future trends. What happened yesterday over in Brazil? Well, they had a wonderful time. About 500,000 people turned out to protest against the government. How come? Well, they're in a recession. Inflation is skyrocketing, and the currency is plummeting. Take a look over there in Chile, not too far away. Hey, you want some really hot real estate? I can get you in a real good deal on some commercial stuff just built. I could rent it to you for almost nothing because copper prices have collapsed. They're at their six-year lows. Go back to Brazil. They're not exporting natural resources the way they were before because you also talked about China. China gobbles up over 50% of most of the world's exports of raw materials each year. And we saw their numbers come out for July. What was exports down? Almost 9%. Keep going. Mexico, hey, how about that peso? Yeah, it's back to what? Oh, when they revalued it in 1993, those levels? Yeah, those levels. You think you're going to see immigration? Hey, how about Colombia? Oh, it's wonderful with those slumping gas prices and oil prices. They're not exporting either. You think they want to leave there? So you go after country from South America, go to from Africa, South Africa. Hey, how about those gold prices, palladium prices? How about Australia, Rio Tinto? How about Anglo-American? How about them Anglo-American firing 53,000 people because they're not producing? Where are they going? You mentioned the wars in Libya brought to us by our Nobel Peace Prize winner, Hillary Clinton, Samantha Powers, and Susan Rice, total disarray. When Gaddafi was in there, they weren't flooding out of the shores of Tripoli into Italy, into Greece.
Hundreds die a week going across the Med just to Italy. One island in Greece, Lesbos, has 156,000 refugees on one tiny island. This is the collapse of the world. But our media tells us everything's fine, and Gerald Celente and Alex Jones are fear porn dealers.
Yeah, well, again, we just stick with the facts. They suck up to the people that pay them their money. So what you're looking at is a global collapse. Oh, I forgot about Yemen. Yeah, the United States and our allies, the beheaders in chief. How many things slaughter so far beheaded in Saudi Arabia this year? I think it's up to 127. ISIS has a long way to go to catch up to them. They're slaughtering people in the poorest country in the Middle East, Yemen. Where are they flooding to? They're flooding into Greece. They're flooding into Italy, Afghanistan. You mentioned Greece. Flooding into Greece. You look at what's going on in Egypt. You look what's going on in Iraq. You look what's going on in Somalia, Sudan. It's chaos. The global economy has collapsed. Commodity prices are down to 2002 levels. We were in a recession in 2002.
And Gerald, I looked it up. Since they created the National Grain Reserves in World War II, it's never been empty. The government has exhausted the grain. I mean, they've never done that.
And you look at coal, look at, as I said, commodity prices, corn. From corn to coal to copper to iron ore, everything has collapsed. China's not buying the stuff. Look at the data. Look what just came out today.
Stay there. Stay there. Gerald Celente, trends forecaster, joins us. This is important, folks. We're not being negative. We want you to get ready. What you don't know can and will hurt you in many cases. That's why we're here trying to follow exactly what's happening. It's kind of like Japan building nuclear reactors right down the mountain from a quasi-active volcano. It's not a good idea. Well, letting private banks and brokerage firms create $2.2 quadrillion in the last few decades of fake money and then letting themselves leverage that to buy up the world and then have us sign on to it, that doesn't sound like a very good idea. And then siphon off production, raise taxes to the point that civilization starts to crumble with 7.5 billion people. It's a time bomb. And if you look at the footage of the illegals in Europe coming in on boats and running across into the fences by the thousands at a time, now we have footage like that in the United States. And then the incentive to bring people here and get free stuff, it is a ticking time bomb, a total ticking time bomb. And this is about the political takeover of this country. Gerald Celente, this is a short segment, long segment coming up. Again, thank you for joining us here on the Alex Jones Show. Gerald Celente from trendsresearch.com. Continue. You were getting into the world melting down around us. People now know it's like Trump says, make America great again. Well, I thought we're already great, according to mainstream media. Are people waking up to the fact that we are not in this wonderful economy like they've been saying?
Oh, absolutely. You know, the polls all show it. And as I was saying, the current events are forming future trends. You know, you just look at what the numbers that came out of Japan. Their second quarter GDP, it was down 1.6%. This is after pumping in trillions of yen under the guise of Abenomics. You remember, they did it, by the way, just as the Fed announced that they were going to end quantitative easing. 3 days later, back in October, a year ago, the Japanese pulled the stunt that they were going to dump in more money into Abenomics, and it boosted up the economy. Fake. It only boosts up the equity markets, as all this cheap dough is done. The facts are right before us. You have the yen sinking in value, and they still can't export enough stuff to have a positive GDP. This is simply basic. The number is right there.
What does it do with the yuan being driven down, and is it doomsday clock for global market crash 1 minute to midnight, like the Telegraph says?
Well, again, you know what I say. Everybody knows a little bit about history. Try this one on. Currency wars, trade wars, world wars. That was World War II. You're looking at the facts over here in New York. They just had the manufacturing index come out. Alex, it's down 15%. What a recovery. I guess it's the cold winter, huh? Well, look, I mean, yes, it's a hot summer. Look, numbers are in front of us. We're looking at numbers. That index, by the way, it's the lowest since April of 2009. Go back 2 months ago, the IMF came out and forecast that growth in 2015 is back to 2009 levels. And then you're looking, as I said, the commodity prices. Hey, you're over there in Texas. You remember all those boom towns everywhere from North Dakota, Wyoming, every boom, boom with the shale. What's going on now? Last week you saw, what was it, Samson's over there, bankruptcy in Oklahoma.
And the fall of the fracking industry and the domestic drilling is going to just devastate at least 6-7 states. It's going to be much bigger than the subprime crisis, in my view.
Well, look again. Look at the facts. You saw all of these hedge funds and all of these private equity groups and speculators and banks dumping tons of money into there, boosting up their industry, and the junk bonds in the United States, 15% to 20% are in the energy industry. It doesn't take a genius to figure this one out. The thing is collapsing in front of everybody's eyes. The facts are all there. They cannot be covered up. Can they be manipulated? Of course they can. You know, we talk about gold prices. By the way, they're moving back up. What brought gold prices down? Hey, how about over there in China when the Shanghai Gold Index shorted gold in 2 minutes in July, when the Japanese markets were closed? They usually trade about 16 tons a day. In 2 minutes on the Shanghai Gold Exchange, they shorted 33 tons. So the collapse is here, but the crooks, criminals, cowards, liars, freaks, and fools called the Federal Reserve and the governments around the world will do anything to manipulate it, as they did with the market today.
That's right.
In the United States.
Stay there. Let's talk about that when we come back.
136.
Stay there. When we come back, long segment, we'll get into how they're manipulating and skimming off the top as they sink the ship and as they run to their armored bunkers. I mean, what are they thinking? Stay with us. By the way, we are now a national distributor for a bunch of the best optics and G-Shock watches, you name it, through HD Firearms. We sell through the InfoWarsStore.com platform at the discounted retail price. you could search hard and find somebody else who's undercutting and maybe find them cheaper. But they are the highest quality super watches, basically, the original, but it's just been updated over and over again. G-Shock is what most of your special forces operators and others wear. They've got very affordable ones right up to super expensive ones. But they are the creme de la creme, the full selection at InfoWarsStore.com. You get a G-Shock watch, get some great night vision optics, whatever it is you're looking for, from inexpensive to the creme de la creme at the lowest prices, laser sights, you name it. This is what all the special forces operators that run head down, as they drop ship for us, have distributor ships for, what they believe is the best. And they have a lot of teams in the field, Army and Navy and Marines, that are using basically their chosen rigs and setups. But this is all just really good stuff. It's because you go to other shopping carts and it'll have just everything, including crud mixed in. So people that don't know what they're doing end up buying crap that sometimes costs even more than the real deal. So we've got it all right there. InfoWarsStore.com of the, it's got to be like 600, 700 items we carry now. The best little portable cook stoves, the best little solar-powered shortwave radios, the best non-GMO seed kits. It's just books, films, Patriot apparel to wake people up, bumper stickers, InfoWarsStore.com. G-Shock Watch is a huge selection and more. InfoWarsStore.com. Brain Force sold so fast the first day it came in, I thought it'd sell out by Friday, but it slowed down, selling very briskly. Another shipment of it. What is it? More than 10 key compounds known to naturally give your brain the metabolites and things it needs to operate healthy. It's not a bunch of speed. It's just natural enzymes and key herbs that just totally turbocharge you. I usually only take one a day, sometimes two a day, because I can get a little too aggressive when I take two. Some people take more. BrainForce and InfoWarsLife.com. It's getting rave reviews. Thank you all for your support when you fund InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com. Alabama Eddie in Auburn, Alabama says, started with one a day for a few days, saw slight changes in focus, then one with breakfast and another mid-morning. That's when I could tell the difference, and it's becoming more profound as time progresses. I'm on the waiting list for more. In words, kudos. Well, more is back in, Alabama Eddie, so thank you so much for believing us that it's high quality, getting it, using it. It's got two ingredients that are prescription in Europe. So research it for yourself. Find out that comparable formulas are twice as much or more. Brain Force, InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. And that funds our operation. Also, the Nightly News is subscriber. We're going to be making some very big announcements in the next 2 weeks about that. It's going to be free to air on satellite everywhere, but still, that costs me $40,000 a year because federally, you got to do $10,000 a month. $40,000 a month. $10,000 a month. Of that is just the closed captioning. That's the cheapest we could get. Where it's federal law. It's a person doing it 4 hours a day, $10,000 a month for that. Then, like, altogether, it's about $40,000 a month to put us up on main satellites. So TV, UHF, VHF, cable, wherever can pick it up. We've already got them lining up and picking it up without even announcing it. I guess I just did announce it. It's already up, but I'm going to kind of formalize it and make the big announcement. I'm not the guy that, like, says, coming up, we're going to cover this. And then I'll say, no, we'll do it now. But I'll lay the full thing out soon. It's just, that's very inexpensive way to get on satellites covering all of North America from Mexico up to Alaska, from out in the Atlantic Ocean over to the Pacific. And if we're able to launch it and successful, I'll put us on satellites in Europe, everywhere else. But you add it all together, when you buy the products, it helps fund the operation. And that's what our goal is, to get more reporters, more writers, and then kind of round it out with two or three more reporters, a couple more camera people and editors, a couple more writers, and we're going to be done. Because it's too hard to try to go out and make the money to fund all this, but you've helped us. So I'd rather spend all my time on news and information. And you've been helping us and supporting us, so I've been able to do some of that. So thank you. We've also done it by bringing you great products. So it's a win-win for everybody. And then it's important to support folks and get us free updates. You can sign up via email at trendsresearch.com or sign up for the quarterly magazine. Invaluable information to read yourself, but give to friends and family at trendsresearch.com. All right, Gerald Celente, you got cut off by the break. You were getting into where you see all this going. And then I want to shift gears into some of the culture control and ask you what you think the elite's endgame is. But They're literally counting their money up on the deck of the Titanic as it's listing. They're not even smart enough to get in the lifeboats first. I guess some elites are. How close are we to the big event, or is it just still this slow slide? And like Baghdad Bob, his U.S. tanks are 2 miles away and fighter jets are flying behind him bombing. He's going, the Americans have been kicked out of Iraq. They're not even in the country. I mean, it seems like that's what they're doing, denying what's happening in the economy.
Yeah, well, they are. I just want to comment also that how important it is that the listeners support the products and buy the products that you're selling because of the highest quality and to put their money where their mind is. Because if they don't support people like yourself, the Trends Journal, and others that are putting out this information that you can't find anywhere else, they're really stopping the progress of freedom. Because for us to make freedom ring, you know, we're in a capitalist society, and there's nobody behind the curtain giving us this dough to make it happen. And I know how hard you work, and you know how hard we work to make it happen. So I really urge everyone to do the best you can, to spend the most you can in supporting enterprises like PrisonPlanet.com and the products that they have, those high-quality products, and, of course, the Trends Journal. So in looking at where the real money is putting their money, it's flooding out of China. They're dumping out of there as quick as they can because they know the collapse is underway. You look at also in the United States, you're looking at exodus is coming in a lot of the equity markets. They're getting their dough out. A lot of people expect it to happen, but they're only keeping the suckers in. It's like what they did in China. You know, some 80% of that Shanghai index was supported by the government promoting it to the little people.
Hold on a minute. I'm going to give you the floor, but I want to go back here because I live in Austin, one of the only boom towns in the United States. And it's so politically correct, I don't say this meanly, I'm making an observation. When I do go to nice areas of Austin or go to a nice outdoor mall or something, just so happen to be near luxury places, there's just rich Chinese in $200,000 Mercedes and Ferraris, and their kids are driving Ferraris or brand new $100,000 Audis. And it's like, all the rich Mexicans seem to have moved to Austin, which, you know, fine with me, you know, that makes it more prosperous. The rich Chinese are like parachuting in. You were talking about that a few years ago, that the rich Chinese were leaving. That shows they know it's going under. So now they're trying to just pump it up with the general public in. That's what's so scary. So the Chinese and Mexicans are running to the U.S., but the banker robber barons are running to New Zealand and to armored redoubts in the Ozarks. Doesn't that really signify the big crisis is almost here? Sorry.
Yes, I believe the crisis is going to happen before the end of the year. And, you know, we're putting, you know, it's a forecast. You know, could we be wrong? Of course we can. And you know, the Trends Journal is 54 pages, full color. There's not one advertisement in there. So what I have to say is has nothing to do with people paying me to say it because we're getting advertising money. And so I am bullish on gold. I've said it when gold was down, you know, another $50 lower than it is now, that I believe that the bottom of gold was around 1100, 1050. And I still believe that's the bottom. The upside potential to me is well over 2000. And you're seeing it going back up because all of a sudden they lumped gold in as another commodity that was going down. No, gold is a safe haven commodity. And no, gold is not pegged to the dollar in the sense that where the dollar gold goes, gold goes. The only reason the dollar has any strength at all is because of all these other economies I was talking about that are collapsing. Look what's going on in Russia. The GDP is down, what, 4.5%? Look what's going on in China, as I mentioned. You have a GDP that most experts believe is around 4%, and already where it is at 7%, with their official number, that's down to two decades low. So gold is the safe haven commodity. You don't peg it, at least I don't, to whether it is going to be inflation, whether it's, no, it has nothing to do with that. To me, it has to do with, here, I'll give you an example. Suppose you lived in Brazil. Suppose you see your Brazilian real now going back, what, to 16-year lows. and gold is pegged on a dollar, and all of a sudden you see your currency crashing against the dollar, what if you own gold? Wouldn't you be better off? Hey, you don't even have to go that far. Take a trip up to Canada. Yeah, look, they're in a recession. Take a look at the Canadian dollar. Oh, wow. The loonie's losing it. It's down to 2004 levels. Hey, how come? Ah, cost a lot of money, doesn't it, to produce that oil out of those tar sands. And oil prices are way down. Oh, you talked about New Zealand? Woof! Watch that one go down, Alex, as milk prices and dairy prices are plummeting. Again, it's commodities across the board. New Zealand's not doing so well anymore. So you're going to look at the Aussie dollar, six-year lows. I mentioned Anglo-American, Rio Tinto, whether it's Royal Dutch Shell, layoffs by the tens of thousands.
No, you're right. You predicted that the 2008 thing wouldn't work, and within 10 years, 7 to 10 years, it would fall apart. And the media just keeps saying, no, everything's fine, everything's wonderful. 2 plus 2 equals 5 or 20 or whatever Obama says it is today. Let's look at now other areas of this. Looking at China, looking at Japan, looking at Europe, looking at Greece, looking at all the things that are happening. The elite go into Gaddafi, who was investing most of the country's money in building up an infrastructure in Africa that the globalists didn't control. They blew it up, destabilized the whole continent. Same thing with Syria, overthrowing our allies in Egypt, shutting down our power plants here, only giving central inside guys the free money from the banker bailouts, the free interest money. Clearly, the globalists are trying to destroy the economy of the world while exempting themselves from their own rules and regulations to consolidate it. But then they destroy the planet that they're stealing at the same time, but they can't seem to help their predatory instinct. Where does all this end up going? Well, they'll try to create sectarian divide and conquer, balkanization. They'll say a sorority video showing a bunch of white girls is racist, but, you know, it's okay to have a black bar or a Hispanic bar or whatever. They will have people wiping their butts with Confederate flags as a distraction. You know, it just goes on and on, these little petty issues, while all of us lose our freedoms. How do we cut through that fog and let people realize that this is a crisis? And here's my other question. I kind of alluded to it. Is there a method to the white shoe boys, as you call them, madness? Because they clearly want to destabilize and make everybody else bankrupt they don't control. Don't they get they're screwing over the markets that allow them to operate?
No, they're ruthless and they're driven. They don't have the morality to think past money and power. So it's not even, you know, again, you just look by their deeds, you shall know them. So they don't understand that destroying the earth is destroying their lives as well. This is who they are. And on this racial issue, a good friend of mine, just this past weekend, had an issue where she was trying to back out and a bunch of black people surrounded a car and saying, you know, colored people count. And this is a woman, you know, she's the furthest thing from a racist you ever want to see. And so what they're doing is they're using that divide and conquer. If African Americans have anybody to point their finger at with hate and disgust, it should be at the President of the United States. This isn't a racist nation. They're making it one. Let's make this really clear. If this was a racist nation, are there racists in the nation? Of course there are. Hey, there are people that don't like Italians, don't like Hispanics, don't like Jews. You're always going to find ignorant people. But a racist nation would never have elected a black president.
Plus, everybody wouldn't be trying to get here. We're not perfect, but we've been a really cool country, and they're just diverting, getting us all fighting with each other because the globalists are robbing us. It's so stupid.
And Alex, just to keep making the point, if it was a racist nation, we would not have had the top guy ahead of law as a black man, Eric Holder, and now Loretta Lynch, another black woman. We would not have the head of the United Nations, it was Susan Rice. You would not have a Secretary of State as Condoleezza Rice or Colin Powell or others. So let's not call it a racist nation. If you want to point the finger, point it at Obama. Point it at Holder. Point it at that low-life man who never convicted one head of the White Shoe Boys. Too white for you, Eric? You're afraid of them, Eric, as you're putting all the other people of color in jail? Hey, Eric. Hey, Miss Lynch. Yeah, Lynch, how about you? How about you who convicted five banks? Oh, excuse me, six of felonies. Convicted of felonies for rigging the LIBOR rate and the Forex market. And did not prosecute one. So if African Americans have a problem with the government, why don't you call it what it is? Your own people have sold you out for the White Shoe Boys.
Well, absolutely. A white president couldn't get away with doubling the black unemployment. It's not even an issue that black people are getting totally screwed over by every metric. And so, of course, Obama's screaming race all day as a diversion, and it's working.
As I said, they're lynching us. That's who Lynch is lynching. She won't lynch the boys on Wall Street. They only go after we, the little people. Hey, the FBI got a couple in Mississippi that was going to go to Syria and join ISIS. What are you kidding me or what? Big deal. That's who they're going after. They make a big deal out of little news as they give their guys a free ride, and they're causing hate and division among us. And it's terrible. And it's going to continue unless we, the people, bring morality and justice.
Absolutely. Stay there. Stay there, Gerald. They want us dumbed down and confused at each other's throats while they rob us all blind, no matter what color we are. Training our children that they're prisoners. Banning dodgeball. Banning speech. Generation by generation, the freedom disappears. Now we're hitting the wall. Here's an article at Infowars.com. It's amazing. There's video. Little Terror, airport security confiscates kids' fart blaster toy from the movie Minions. And it looks like a purple ray gun speaker machine. Doesn't even look like a gun. Any moron can tell that this is a toy, but this is the idea of the nanny state. This is how horrible it is. So I'm going to commit a thought crime right now and actually show the hypothetical fart gun in action from the movie Despicable Me. Here it is.
And here, of course, is the new weapon you ordered.
I can't believe Hillary Clinton stars in that show as the mad scientist. You know, Hillary's in that. Getting back to Gerald Celente of Trends Research. Gerald, you were getting into something very important as we hit that break. In summation, you say you see us hitting a major bump in the road by the end of the year. A lot of folks are saying that now. I hope you're wrong. I hope I'm wrong. But the indicators are there. Ron Paul saying it. How long can this go on? And how? What's the main scenario you see?
Well, when we're talking about the racial divide, that's going to really pit people against each other. So it's going to become very ugly unless we have somebody that's leading us that brings morality back into the show. And, you know, Ron Paul was the last person that was out there that was really doing anything across the board of making something like that happen. And I just don't see that happening now. So the racial divide will worsen. You're going to have a lot of social unrest. And it's global. As I said, there were 500,000 people yesterday in Brazil. It's happening all over the world. So they're going to divide and conquer is going to be the scenario. Oh, and you mentioned about Homeland Security. I believe the head of that is a black person, too. So how about that for a racist country? You know, we got a guy like that arresting little kids for fart guns.
Well, it turns out Nancy Pelosi has her staff out running this, even in D.C., who lives in the lap of luxury. I mean, imagine you're just pulling out your car and people surround you, chanting at you because you're white. Don't they understand that's the opposite of what Martin Luther King said? They have no idea what you stand for, but it's because you're white you must have done something because MSNBC said so?
Again, that's the way they're selling it. So there's a divide and conquer. It's going to be a very difficult time coming. And again, as you know, Alex, we're launching Occupy Peace over here in Colonial Kingston. And here's the photo. But it's more than just peace overseas. It's to stop this mindset. It's to bring peace back to the United States. That's why it's OccupyPeace.us. Because if we don't have it, we're going to lose it. And we're doing everything we can to make that happen. Because they're just dividing us more and more.
It's clear something big is coming, because the weaponization of CNN, MSNBC, the most obvious Klan-level race baiting, is just so dirty, so nasty, so transparent, but it's working like a charm.
Well, it's like what happened when they killed a kid, what, North Carolina, South Carolina, that didn't do anything, and he was white. They don't show that. They're doing it. They're making it a racial issue when it's much bigger than that.
Yeah, there are some out-of-control militarized psycho cops, and it's a terrible situation, but killing each other and surrounding an old white lady's car isn't going to fix it. It's going to maybe turn her into a racist if she wasn't one. Gerald, great job. Thank you so much. Look forward to having you on soon. Thank you for all your important work.
Thank you, and thank you for all you do.
Thank you. I'm going to come back with a bit of Overdrive and some issues we didn't cover. Infowars.com/show to find that feed. Support our local affiliates. I covered most of the news today, but there's a lot of important stuff I didn't get to. I may shoot a special report just for the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock, because of it. You know, Gerald has been on the show for, I don't know, about 10, 11, now about 12 years. Been on the show since about 2003 or 4. And he's never really gotten too worried about the whole Balkanization racial divide. But you heard him up in Kingston, New York. Yeah, I mean, it's happening all over the country. Because you're white, you get chanted at, you get yelled at, you get people saying things to you. I experienced a little bit of this in the 80s in Dallas. But now I've experienced it in East Austin. And I've been living here 24 years. And it's just bizarre. It's really bad. But it's because mainstream media that has credibility with Democrats especially is saying that white people are sneaking around out to get you and they hate you and they're the reason you don't have jobs. And again, some old random white person or some kid is out to get you while a bunch of offshore banks loot us. And overthrow countries and kill people. And it's classic divide and conquer. And I look at how they make it this big victory to dig up Confederate generals. I mean, I don't care if you do that. But the point is, you think you're having this big victory. Black Lives Matter activists wipe their butts with Confederate flag. Group waves communist flags during confrontation. The photos and news articles are linked in the article by Paul Joseph Watson. And I'm going to show some of this. Viewer discretion advised. We're going to scroll down. People basically have American flags crammed in their rear ends, flipping people off. And it only degrades them. But I guess this is a new movement to cram American flags up your rear end. And I'm sorry to talk about this, but it's a medical mental illness issue, in my opinion. And always a bunch of white liberal commies waving the red flags with black people marching with them. I mean, it's just despicable. It's so stupid. And then, yeah, you got some white sorority. It's not officially white, but it's all a bunch of rich white girls. I bet if you're poor, you're not invited. I'm not knocking the sorority. That's just how they are. There's some elite sorority of richy rich daughters. Two white sorority videos slammed for being racially homogeneous. So you can have a Hispanic group, black groups, whatever. You can have their fraternities. But if a group looks like it's almost completely white, why, it's evil. And that's a double standard, and it's wrong, but it's all part of this Balkanization. A University of Alabama sorority recruitment video was slammed as being racially homogeneous and objectifying women because it features a number of attractive, thin, white girls. The video shows a group of mostly white women partying and dancing to promote the Alpha Pi, who are based in the particular campus. However, the clip set up a firestorm of criticism from AL.com writer A.L. Bailey, asserting that the video was worse for women than Donald Trump. It's also racially and aesthetically homogeneous and forced, so hyper-feminine, so reductive, so objectifying, and so Stepford wife. I don't know if it was a group of hot Hispanic women or black women dancing around a house. It doesn't look too objectifying to me. It looks like a bunch of girls having fun. By the way, all the really successful women are like that, and then they also wear suits and are successful in other ways, but they get the power of feminism, of true femininity. Feminism itself is a fake projection on the women to destroy their power. And it's disgusting. But that's the type of stuff that's going on. I mean, the media says it's great to stick American flags in the crack of your pants and act like an idiot because it's, you know, straight out of Mac Daddyville. When that's not even black culture. Blacks were some of the most sharp-dressed people 50, 60 years ago in this country. Now MTV takes a particular punk-type dress from prisons, meaning that you're the sex slave. They put it out, and all the white kids I see, a lot of them seem to think it's fun to have their pants hanging around their ankles or, you know, hanging down over their butts. And all that means is you're a punk. I mean, it's all a sick joke. And you see these young people, and I'm like, man, why are you dressed like...